Nun werde ich euch beweisen, dass Gott, wenn es ihn gibt, böse ist. Hat Gott alles, was existiert, erschaffen? Wenn Gott alles erschaffen hat, dann hat er auch das Böse geschaffen. Das bedeutet, Gott ist böse.
Herr Professor, existiert Kälte?
Was für eine Frage soll das sein? Natürlich existiert die Kälte. War euch noch nie kalt?
Nein, in der Tat, Herr Professor, die Kälte existiert nicht. Nach den Gesetzen der Physik ist das, was wir als kalt empfinden, nur das Fehlen von Wärme. Und existiert Dunkelheit, Herr Professor?
Selbstverständlich existiert sie.
Nein, sie ist nur das Fehlen von Licht. Wir können das Licht messen, aber die Dunkelheit nicht. Das Böse existiert nicht, genau wie die Kälte und die Dunkelheit. Gott hat das Böse nicht geschaffen. Es ist das Ergebnis dessen, was Gottes Hand noch nicht berührt hat.
This is the resting scan. This is the prayer scan, showing increased activity in the frontal lobes and in the language area of the brain.
And when Andy looks at the brains of people who do not believe in God, he finds that simple, quiet meditation produces none of the brain activity of believers.
This was a scan of an atheist. We actually had them meditating or contemplating God, showing that the frontal lobes don't activate, as opposed to the person praying who does.
To an atheist, God is unimaginable, is unimaginable, is unimaginable, is unimaginable, is unimaginable.
But I can tell you, because I spent about an hour and a half with this, that all of the lines are completely parallel and completely perpendicular to each other. Okay? And even though I'm telling you that, and even though I know this, it's almost impossible to change your mind's perspective on the world. So now, change that into thinking about science or thinking about religion. When people have a particular perspective on the world, even if there is a tremendous amount of data that may be to the contrary, it's often very difficult for our brain to accept what it already thinks about the world. And unfortunately, it doesn't bother to tell you what it's doing to your own perspectives about the world. So we have this ongoing struggle and problem with how we look at the world and how we begin to assess whether it's time to change our views and our perspective on the world.
Josh Feuerstein here. You know, a lot of people have asked me, how is it that you can believe in a God that you've never seen? Well, the reality is we believe in things that we've never seen all the time. I can walk through a gallery of art, and even though I didn't see the painter paint the painting, even though I may not be there to shake his hand, the reality is he exists, and I have proof because I look at his art. I look at his paintings the same way that a hunter can be tracking a deer or a bear, and even though he's never seen it and laid eyes on it, he's seen its footprints, he's seen its droppings, it's evidence that it's been there. When I look around at other human beings and I look at creation, it's proof to me that there is a creator, the same way that art is proof that there is an artist. You know, it is that we believe in things that we don't see every single day, whether it's heat, well, we feel heat, but we can't see it. Whether it's gravity, well, we feel the effects of it, but we've never been able to see gravity. The reality is that we believe in it. Why? Because we've experienced it and we've felt it. The same way that millions and millions, if not billions of people around this world have felt and experienced God. That's why they can say that they can believe in him. And it doesn't make us better than an atheist who doesn't believe in a God. But yet the atheist cannot even claim to possess the totality of truth. And so how can they say that he doesn't exist? For there is no proof that he doesn't. And yet my experience is proof enough to me that he does. That doesn't make me better than an atheist. It simply means that I've had an experience that he hasn't had. The same way that maybe I could have went to Disneyland and experienced Disneyland while maybe they haven't. It doesn't make somebody better. It just means that they've had an experience and shared something that somebody else hasn't. That's why I'm here today to tell you, if you've never felt God, well, now's the time. The Bible says that he's as close as the mention of his name, and there's literally billions of people around the world that would agree right now with me that they've experienced his love and his mercy and his grace, and maybe maybe right now it's your opportunity to. So I challenge you, no matter where you're at, or maybe today, tonight, sometime in the privacy of your own home or wherever you may be, I challenge you to simply ask God to show himself to you. Maybe not in a visible manifestation, but to make you feel something you've never felt before. I promise it's going to change your life the same way that it changed mine. Hey guys, Josh Feuerstein here. You know, the other day I had an atheist tell me that I was an idiot, moronic, and stupid for believing in God, that he created this world, because it took way too much faith to believe in a process like that, while he believed in what he called the science of evolution. Well, let's go ahead and let's do this. Dear Mr. Atheist, first of all, let me correct you, because evolution is not a science, never has, and never will be. Why? Because it cannot fit within the parameters and parentheses of science for one simple reason. It was never observed. That's why it's not science. That's why it's called the theory of evolution. One man's theory. Now, let me show you how much faith it really takes to believe in evolution. You want me to believe that in some accidental cosmic bang, that out of that was created one cell, and from that one cell that all life springs, every plant, every animal, every single human being, and that somewhere along the way, over years and years, we mysteriously and magically all develop different wills, and we all develop different characteristics and traits, all because we willed it in our... I mean, you really think that everything came from one single cell? How much faith does that take? Now, I realize that you say that evolution is in science. And yet, if we go back to science, the one thing that science demands, if you maybe you've heard of something called the law of thermodynamics, which means that chaos can never produce order. Look at the world that we live in. The sun goes up, the moon comes out, we travel around the sun, we have years, we have days, we have seasons, the tide comes in and out. Everything works like a clock. It has order. And yet, you cannot argue that a world that has order came out of an accident, because it defies the very logic and laws of science. You see, you think it takes a lot of faith for me to believe in a God that created this world, a God that created order. And yet, what if I were to tell you that somewhere in Oklahoma, a tornado rolls through a junkyard full of a bunch of old cars, and somewhere on the other side of that tornado, out of that junk pile, it magically produces a perfectly red, shiny, working Lamborghini. You would tell me I was nuts. You would tell me that I had lost it. You would probably try to admit me into the psychiatric ward. Why? Because that is absolutely stupid. I mean, how much faith would it really take to believe something as idiotic as that? And yet that's exactly what science believes. Science believes that in this accident came this perfectly working earth with human life and with people and animals and plants and seasons and days and hours and rotates. I mean, the atmosphere, everything in earth was created perfectly. And I'm telling you, that could never happen through an accident. It had to be by intelligent design. So dear Mr. Atheist, who really has to have a lot of faith today to believe in their theory? I believe in God because I've experienced him, I've felt him, but most of all, while driving through Yellowstone and Montana and so many of these natural reserves this week, and looking at animals and looking at life, I don't know, I just can't look at all of that creation and say that it was an accident. I have to say that creation has a creator. And one final thought. Well, the word universe, you believe in a Big Bang, but when I look at the word universe, it means una, which is one or singular. That's Latin, una, verse. Verse means a spoken statement. So universe is one single spoken statement. I dare you to read Genesis 1. And in the beginning, God said, let there be. All God had to do was speak one single spoken statement, and boom, the universe. Josh Feuerstein here. So I've been issued a challenge to publicly prove that God exists and that atheism and evolution are illogical and just plain don't make sense, and without using a Bible. So here we go. You know, it's funny because a lot of times people that don't want me to use a Bible, they say things like, oh my God, I mean, that's just so illogical. I mean, evolution is the only logical explanation. But let's really look at how logical evolution really is. I mean, imagine that you've never read a history book and all of a sudden you're driving through South Dakota and you see a mountain with four big faces on it. Well, we know it's Mount Rushmore. more, but say you didn't, and say all of a sudden you see it, would you just assume that that was a product of evolution, that the mountain had just evolved that way? Or would you think that maybe that there had been an artist or a designer that had somehow carved those faces into that mountain? I mean, I want you to really think about it. Think about the house that I live in, or that even you live in. Think about the car that you drive. Those are complex beings, and yet each one of them has a blueprint. I mean, do you really think that the human body was built without a blueprint? Especially looking at DNA, the fact that inside of you that there's a 3 billion letter code that specifically tells exactly how you're made up. Doesn't that prove intelligent design? The fact that your body has a blueprint, how can it have a blueprint if it doesn't have a designer? I mean, think about the earth that we live in. Think about the fact that it's 8,000 miles in diameter. Think about the fact that it's 93 million miles from the sun. If it was any larger, well, the air would be far too dense and turn into water and cover the earth. If it was any farther or closer to the sun, we would either freeze or we would burn to death. Think about the fact that it's tilted 23.5 degrees, which allows us seasons. Think about the fact that it's the right distance from the moon, that when it spins, that it's able to control the tides. Think about the fact that the atmosphere is 78% nitrogen and 21% oxygen. I mean, even Stephen Hawking, the great physicist, had to admit that the universe and its laws of physics seem to be specifically designed for us. Now think about this. When it comes to evolution, the one reason that evolution can never match up with science is that an organism has never been shown to gain genetic information. So how could something evolve from an atom, well, to a human being? How could it become molecule to man? You know, I realize that there's a lot of people out there that draw pictures of apes and they're just this evolution into humans, but I could do the same thing with a flower and a windmill. But it doesn't mean that it's true. It's a good artist and a good story. But the fact is that there's not one organism that has ever shown us that it has added genetic information. In fact, science has actually proven that organisms lose genetic information over time. So how could something evolve when it's actually in the process of devolving? Another nail in the coffin of evolution? Well, this is just plain and simple. It's never been proven that life can come from non-life. End of story. Now, I want to tell you today that you have been designed by a God that loves you, a God that is life. And maybe today you're feeling inside of your heart, well, that you're just dead and you just feel down and you feel depressed. You just feel like you don't have any life left inside of you. I want you to know that through a relationship with Jesus Christ, that you can have that life yet again, that you can feel overjoyed, that you can feel full of peace and love and joy and happiness and all of these things. I was in your same condition not long ago, but now his love has filled me overflowing, and I feel the way, the truth, and the life, which is Jesus Christ. I want to promise you today that if you just begin a conversation with him, he's waiting to talk with you. He's waiting to have a conversation that I promise is going to change your life. So God bless you. Have a great day. If you agree with me, please take a moment and click share. That's how this message gets spread around the world. There's thousands of atheists that are out there that are waiting to hear this logical explanation of how the Bible makes way more sense than some theory of evolution.
About 15 billion years ago, there were no stars in the sky. There wasn't even a sky. All that existed was the primordial fireball. Primordial fireball. Primordial
then, fireball. Primordial. Something happened. In a flash, everything suddenly expanded. This was how it all began. The first moment of existence, what we now call the Big Bang. Big Bang. Big Bang. Big Bang. Big Bang.
At the beginning of the 20th century, scientists believed that the universe had always existed, that matter energy was infinite. It had always been around. The model is called the steady state model, because the model of the universe that it's been around forever basically doesn't change. The universe is steady state. But what happened in the last 100 years is that model has been blown away because of the evidence. Observations now suggest, as you all know, that the universe began some 12 to 15 billion years ago. The first evidence that the universe had a beginning is the expanding universe.
Researchers wanted to believe in a universe that always was and always will be eternal. But galaxies flying away from each other meant that once, long ago, they were clumped together. It meant something started them moving. The universe had a beginning. Today, it's called the Big Bang Theory.
This was first discovered in 1929 by Edwin Hubble, And it's the first evidence that the universe had a beginning. The second evidence the universe had a beginning is the cosmic background radiation.
The discovery of the cosmic background radiation was a fatal blow to those who wanted to believe in an eternal universe. The Big Bang proponents had won.
Now the final evidence for the origin of the universe is the relative abundance of light elements. It's very clear now that the universe had an origin, and scientists have become to accept this. In fact, the equations of general relativity that Einstein developed had an origin of the universe. When Einstein developed his equations of general relativity, they showed that there should be an expansion of the universe and an origin, and Einstein didn't like that. He added something called a cosmological constant, which he later realized was not there. When we saw that the universe was expanding, that there really was an origin, he threw out the cosmological constant. He said that that was the biggest mistake of his scientific career, But when this Big Bang model was first proposed in the early part of the 20th century, it was received with great skepticism by the scientific community. Because the scientific community knew that the Big Bang opened up the possibility of having a beginning and a creator and someone who began it.
Have you ever asked yourself where the universe came from? Why everything exists instead of just nothing? Typically, atheists have said that the universe is just eternal and uncaused.
For example, Bertrand Russell, the famous atheist on a radio program, he said the universe is just there and that's all.
But the astrophysical evidence indicates that the universe began to exist in a great explosion called the Big Bang 15 billion years ago. Most laymen do not appreciate that not only were all matter and energy created in that event, but physical space and time themselves. This is of utmost importance, for it implies, as the Cambridge astronomer Fred Hoyle points out, that the Big Bang theory requires the creation of the universe from nothing. Now, this tends to be very awkward for the atheist. For as Anthony Kenny of Oxford University urges, a proponent of the Big Bang theory, at least if he is an atheist, must believe that the universe came from nothing and by nothing. But surely that doesn't make sense. Out of nothing, nothing comes.
Even atheist philosophers such as David Hume, he wrote in a letter, "I never asserted to absurd proposition as that anything might arise without a cause." Similarly, P.J. Zwart, in his publication About Time, said, "If there is anything we find inconceivable, it is that something could arise from nothing."
So, where did the universe come from? Why does the universe exist instead of just nothing? There must have been a cause which brought the universe into being. We can summarize our argument thus far as follows. Premise one: whatever begins to exist has a cause. Two, the universe began to exist. Three, therefore, the universe has a cause.
So the cause of the universe must be immaterial beyond space and time. Now there are only two things that can fit in this category. The first, abstract objects, and the second, an embodied mind. Now, what's the better candidate? Now, abstract objects, the problem with these abstract objects is they're causally effete, meaning they can't cause anything. Like, for example, the number one can't cause anything. So the only alternative is an embodied mind, what theists call God. An embodied mind, immaterial, outside time and space.
order to recognize an explanation as the best, you don't have to have an explanation of the explanation. In fact, when you think about it, requiring that would immediately lead to an infinite regress of explanations. You would need an explanation of the explanation, but in order to recognize that as best, you need an explanation of the explanation of the explanation, and then an explanation of the explanation of the explanation of the explanation. And so that nothing could ever be explained.
And let me tell you why. If we say, what caused the cause that caused the universe, then let's continue. What caused the cause that caused the cause that caused the universe? Let's continue. Then what caused the cause that caused the cause that caused the cause that caused the universe? Let's carry on. Then what caused the cause that caused the cause that caused the cause that caused...
And that goes on and on and on backwards, but at one point, I have to have an uncaused cause, or there would be nothing in existence today. Think of a string of dominoes. You have a domino that knocks over a domino that knocks over a domino. I have to have a first domino, or that string of falling could never start.
For the premises of the argument I gave, everything that begins to exist has a cause. Something cannot come into being out of nothing. But if something is eternal and timeless, then it doesn't fall under that first premise. It doesn't need a cause. And the concept of God is the concept of an eternal, self-existent, necessary being, and therefore the answer is simply that God is uncaused. He is self-existent.
To remind ourselves of the argument again, we have premise one. Whatever begins to exist has a cause. Premise two, the universe began to exist. And from that, we draw the conclusion that the universe had a cause. The universe had a cause. The universe had a
cause. So we ask another question. What is the nature of this cause? And the nature of this cause, upon conceptual analysis, which means critical thinking about this cause, we come to some startling conclusions. This cause must be one. The reason for this is because if we use the philosophical principle Occam's razor, which posits that we do not multiply entities beyond necessity, then we conclude it must be one. This cause must be uncaused, as we have already discussed the absurdity of an infinite regress of events, similarly with causes. This cause must be immaterial because it created the sum of all matter, which is the universe itself. Significantly, brothers, sisters, and friends, this cause must be personal. The reason I'm saying this is how else can an eternal cause bring into an existence a finite effect, the universe that had a beginning in time? It must have chosen the universe to come into existence, and choice indicates a will, and a will indicates a personality. So, we have concluded the traditional view on God, that a transcendental, immaterial, uncaused, eternal being exists.
Some strange results have come up in about the last 20, 30 years, particularly in astronomy and also in quantum physics, which suggests that the universe actually may have a purpose, and some physicists are now suggesting it does have a purpose. And this has come out of some findings about some of the fundamental numbers in atomic physics.
During the past 40 years, scientists have determined the relative strengths of each of these primary laws and forces. These strengths are so critically balanced, they are often described as being finely tuned.
These are numbers like the mass, the weight of an electron, the weight of a quark, the strength of gravity, the strength of the electromagnetic field. About 20 numbers that describe those and other parameters, features of our world, but nobody knows why it is that those numbers have the particular values that they do. Now, you could easily say, yeah, who really cares? You change the mass of the electron by a little bit more, a little bit less, does it really matter? And the answer is it does. See, it turns out that if you imagine that we had 20 dials right here, and we could fiddle with those 20 numbers at will, even a small change to the values of the known values of those numbers would cause the world as we know it to disappear.
Because it turns out, and this is a very surprising, unexpected discovery, that the laws of physics, the basic given fabric of the world, had to be very specific, very finely tuned, as we sometimes say, for the possibility of carbon-based life appearing at all.
For example, the strengths of the other forces are all important, the masses of the various subatomic particles. Now, this is one of a long list of properties in underlying physics that seem to be prerequisites for a universe with life. If all of these things were even a little bit different, then life, certainly life as we know it, could not exist.
It's a very surprising conclusion, but it's true, and all scientists would acknowledge that's the case.
Bernard Carr is a cosmologist and studies how the laws of physics operate in the universe. He says that the laws of nature are so finely tuned to enable complex life to exist that it is extremely unlikely that this could have happened by chance. Such fine-tuning, Carr believes, at least raises the possibility of a tuner.
The fine-tunings, how fine-tuned are they? Most of them are 1% sort of things. In other words, if a thing is 1% different, everything is bad. And a physicist could say, maybe those are just luck. On the other hand, this cosmological constant is tuned to one part and 10 to the 120, 120 decimal places. Nobody thinks that's accidental. That is not a reasonable idea, that something is tuned to 120 decimal places just by accident. That's the most extreme example of fine-tuning.
No force in the history of cosmology has ever been discovered to be that finely tuned. The cosmological constant needs to be set to one part in a trillion, 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 trillion. Otherwise, the universe would be so drastically different that it would be impossible for us to evolve. That the cosmological constant arrived at such a tiny value by chance seemed to be out of the question.
Ils sont nombreux à dire que finalement, quand on regarde l'univers, surtout à l'origine, eh bien, on constate qu'il ne peut pas être né par hasard, et que le hasard n'a aucun rôle, et que plus on remonte loin dans le temps, donc plus on remonte vers le Big Bang, plus on trouve un univers qui est ordonné, réglé, ajusté.
For example, if we go back to say 1 second after the Big Bang, at that point the expansion rate and the mass density have to have been adjusted to each other just right, so that the universe is just at this critical point. If the universe at that point were expanding just one part in the 15th decimal place faster, the universe would have flown apart without galaxies ever having had a chance to form. On the other hand, if the expansion rate were just a little slower than what we think by change of one in the 15th decimal place, then the universe would in fact have expanded to a maximum size and collapsed. We would never have even reached the time in the universe at which we're living.
Alors, ajuster comment? Eh bien, il existe ce qu'on appelle des paramètres cosmologiques. Ce sont des grandes constantes, la constante de la vitesse de la lumière, par exemple, qui fait 300 000 km à la seconde, 7 fois donc le tour de la Terre en une seconde. Il y a la constante de gravitation. Ce sont des chiffres, des données chiffrées, avec un zéro, une virgule, et puis parfois des dizaines de décimales derrière la virgule. Eh bien, si on changeait simplement une seule de ces décimales sur une seule de ces 20 constantes, l'univers ne pourrait pas apparaître. Eh bien, ça signifie que le hasard n'a aucun rôle à jouer à l'origine de l'univers.
But let me come now to the grand design, because like every other physicist, Carl King is confronted with powerful evidence of design in the fine-tuning of the universe. He explains, our universe and its laws appear to have a design that both is tailor-made to support us, and if we are to exist, leaves little room for alteration. That is not easily explained, and raises the natural question of why it is that way. The discovery relatively recently of the extreme fine-tuning of so many of the laws of nature could lead at least some of us back to the old idea that this grand design is the work of some grand designer.
La densité de l'univers, par exemple, doit être réglée à une précision de 10 puissance moins 60, donc qui est égale à la précision qu'un archer doit exercer s'il voulait planter une flèche dans une cible de 1 cm carré, donc comme ça, tout petit comme ça, mais qui sera placé au bord de l'univers à 14 milliards d'années.
À l'autre bout.
Oui, c'est ça. Vous voyez, donc une précision extrême. Hein, c'est vraiment. Alors,
impossible.
Donc la question, est-ce qu'il y a un principe créateur, quelque chose qui règle les choses dès le début, ou, donc ça c'est la nécessité, ou c'est le pur hasard. Mais le pur hasard, quand il y a une probabilité si faible pour que ça aboutisse, il faut donc faire l'hypothèse qu'il y a une infinité d'univers. Si vous jouez la loterie, si vous achetez tous les billets, bien sûr, il y aura un qui aura le gros lot. Donc ici, si vous avez une infinité d'univers, ce qu'on appelle un multivers, chacun ayant une combinaison différente de constantes physiques et de conditions initiales, la plupart sera vide de vie parce que la combinaison des constantes physiques ne sera pas gagnante, sauf dans le nôtre où nous avons la combinaison gagnante.
Est-ce que vous croyez à cette hypothèse multivers ou vous voyez plutôt un univers prédéterminé ?
Donc, je réponds en tant qu'être humain maintenant, pas en tant que scientifique, parce que la science peut admettre des multivers aussi.
J'aimerais avoir votre avis,
oui.
En fait, votre intuition.
Voilà. Donc, j'appelle ça mon pari pascalien. Et bien sûr, je pense que l'univers est... il y a un principe créateur qui a réglé ça tout le début. Et je pense qu'il y a un univers unique parce que c'est mon intuition. C'est difficile de croire quand je vais au télescope, par exemple, de voir toute cette harmonie, cette beauté, cette organisation, de croire que tout est hasard, que rien n'a de sens et que nous sommes là par hasard, que toute cette architecture cosmique est faite par hasard.
As we look at the details of nature, one thing stands out. This is the order, the patterns, the symmetry that surround us. You can see it in a flower, or a snowflake, or even a seashell. What we are seeing is intelligent design, which might be described as God's fingerprints upon nature. One of the more fascinating math relationships was first described back in medieval times, 8 centuries ago. The scholar's name was Leonardo Fibonacci, an outstanding Italian mathematician. He excelled in many areas, and one in particular. He generated a long list of numbers by, in each case, adding together the two previous numbers. You can begin with a 2 and a 3. You add them together and you get 5. Now add 3 and 5 to get 8. Then add 5 and 8 to get 13. The Fibonacci sequence keeps going like this. 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 21, 34, 55, 89, 144, and so on. What Fibonacci realized was that this elegant list of numbers describes many items to be found in nature. For example, flower petals.
L'exemple des pétales d'une marguerite. Vous dites, il n'y a pas de hasard au nombre de pétales d'une marguerite.
Non, absolument. Le nombre des pétales de marguerite est en fait inscrit dans un scénario qu'on pourrait qualifier de scénario cosmologique, c'est-à-dire que tout a été prévu au départ, et que le nombre des
pétales,
c'est incroyable.
Une seule marguerite avec 27 pétales, ça n'existe pas.
Il n'y a pas de pétales,
il n'y a pas de marguerite avec 27, c'est pas possible. C'est pas possible. Et le nombre de pétales d'une marguerite est réglé par une loi mathématique qu'on appelle la suite de Fibonacci.
That there is a mathematically precise structure to the universe and everything in it. One everyday example of this precision can be found in the plants. Many plants, including elm trees, grow their leaves, twigs and branches placed exactly halfway around the stem from each other. Next in the series are plants like the beech tree, with leaves placed one third of the way around the stem from the previous leaves. Third in the series are the plants like the oak, with leaves placed at every two-fifths of a turn. The holly plant is the next at 3/8, while the larch trees are the next at 5/13, and the sequence goes on and on. Notice the number sequence of these fractions. 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8,
13, and so on. Each number is the sum of the two numbers which came just before it in the sequence. This particular mathematical pattern is called the Fibonacci series.
Take, for example, the sunflower. The display of its florets are in perfect spirals of 55, 34, and 21. The sequence of Fibonacci. The sequence of Fibonacci. The sequence of Fibonacci. The sequence of Fibonacci. The fruitlets of the pineapple create the same spiral based on the sequence. The pine cone does the same. As currents move through the ocean and the tide rolls onto the shore, the waves that bring in the tide curve into a spiral that can be mathematically diagrammed onto a plot at the points 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 21, 34, and 55. Buds on trees, sand dollars, starfish, petals on flowers are formed with this exact same blueprint. This blueprint can be seen around us on a small scale every day, but the greatest example of all is directly above our heads. At an average of 100,000 light years across, even the spiral of the galaxies above us are formed with the exact design. With the exact design. With the exact design. This sequence or blueprint appears to be the trademark of a designer, a proof of a creator.
Also known as the golden mean, the divine proportion is a mathematical formulation exhibited in everything from the double helix of DNA.
The DNA molecule, the code for life, is made up of two intertwining spirals. We find the 0.618 ratio between the helix's width and cycle length.
To the form of the human body itself.
Do something like measure the distance from the floor to your navel, and then from your navel to your head. If you're well proportioned, the ratio should be 1 to 1.618, and that ratio is seen all over the beautiful body.
People started noticing it. Artists noticed that the width of the in a beautiful face, for example.
Yeah.
Not in any face, but it had to be beautiful. If a face was beautiful, the width of the mouth was exactly 1.618 times the width of the nose.
Right.
If the face wasn't beautiful, that wasn't the case. Dentists,
yeah,
in their dental work, noticed that the upper front tooth was 1.618 times as wide as the next tooth over, the lateral incisor.
Oh.
So the central incisor was 1.618 times the width of the lateral incisor, the next tooth over.
Wonderful. Give me some more examples.
Your fingers are each called phalanges, uh-huh, and each bone of the finger is called a phalanx. And the phalanx that's the closest to your knuckle here is 1.618 times the phalanx that's in the middle, and that's 1.618 times the length of the phalanx at the end, which is your fingernail. So that was kind of amazing. This number would come up over and over again.
Then we find the Fibonacci ratio in heart muscles, in bronchial tube branching, even in the electrical potential of neurons, and as Roger Penrose pointed out, even in the arrangement of the brain's microtubules.
As we scan our universe from the tiny flower to the awe-inspiring galaxy, we see the fingerprint of God. We see the fingerprint of God. We see the fingerprint of God.
As we're going to show in this broadcast today, that there is no doubt at all anymore that the science of intelligent design absolutely crushes any competition, absolutely crushes any other theory about the nature of the universe that we live in. It's over. There is simply no contest. The preeminent theory, model, science of reality from this point forward, I declare on this show, is the science of intelligent design. The science of intelligent design. And the absolute proof. I mean, absolute. I'm using a strong word there. Proof is going to be given to you today, in just a minute here. I just can't even believe it, to be honest. Discoveries like what I'm about to discuss to you just never cease to amaze me. for many reasons, that it's all covered. Nobody knows, it's covered up. And, well, since I was taught growing up that the world was basically a random universe, to find out such hardcore, distinct verification that that's a lie just never ceases to amaze me. So here's the information. So here's the information. I'm reading from the abstract of an article. This is the first of many academic articles I'm going to be discussing with you here today. And these aren't just some academic journals. These are, you go ask your university professor what the most prestigious journal, academic science journals in the world are, and they're going to name the ones that I'm discussing here with you today. Okay? I'm going to read to you right now the journal Nature. Okay? There's a journal called Nature, and there's a journal called Science. Those are the two most, consider the two most prestigious overall academic science journals in the world. And I'm going to read you part of the abstract of one right now. Let me just read. Okay, this is the journal Nature, number 454, pages 362 to 363, March 18, 2010, but put online March 17, 2010. This is by a fellow named Ian Affleck, who teaches apparently in the Department of Physics and Astronomy at the University of British Columbia. Listen to the title of this article. Solid State Physics. Golden Ratio Seen in Magnet. Okay? Okay, so let's go through this Science Daily article. ScienceDaily.com. This was released on January 7, 2010. Title of the article, Golden Ratio Discovered in Quantum World. Hidden Symmetry Observed for the First Time in Solid State Matter. Let's find out what that means. Let's read here. Researchers from Helmholtz, Zentrum, Berlin, and it's some German words, in cooperation with colleagues from Oxford and Bristol universities, as well as the Rutherford Appleton Laboratory, United Kingdom, have for the first time observed a nanoscale symmetry hidden in solid state matter. Okay, did you catch that? This is the first time any symmetry of any sort has been observed in the nanoscale, okay, the quantum scale. Remember, quantum physics is the study of the base level energies of nature. Okay, the smallest building blocks that make up everything, little pieces of energy, like the electron or the muon or the quark. Okay, so specifically, what was found in this study was that chains of atoms lined up together form what's sort of like a string, and it resonates a frequency or pitch. What do you know? The pitch is in the ratio of 1.618, the golden ratio. Let me just read this paragraph to you. It says, Science Daily, again, January 7, 2010, golden ratio discovered in quantum world. By turning the system and artificially introducing more quantum uncertainty, the researchers observed that the chains of atoms acts like a nanotech guitar string. Dr. Radu Koldia from Oxford University, who is the principal author of the paper and drove the international project from its inception a decade ago until the present, explains, here the tension comes from the interaction between spins causing them to magnetically resonate. For these interactions, we found a series scale of resonant notes. The first two notes show a perfect relationship with each other. Their frequencies, pitch, are in the ratio of 1.618. This is just amazing. There's no defense that a random universe theorist in academia can give to counter this. There's no reason at all that the quantum base of reality should be exhibiting the specific number of the golden ratio if we live in a random universe. All the competing theories, evolution, random universe theories, all the junk from academia no longer competes in any way with intelligent design science, intelligent design theory. When you hear a scientist say on the Discovery Channel or something, an academic, a professional, say there's no evidence for intelligent design, it's all a silly little parlor game, and there's all this evidence for evolutionary science and the academic theories for the origins of the universe, you can know two things. One, we have to be compassionate because they simply don't know the empirical data. Okay? They have no idea. Academics typically only talk on their closed little worlds and only accept information from their closed little worlds. And the second thing we can know, and make no mistake about it, is they are absolutely propagandizing the world with all of their theses about the nature of the universe that we live in, where we come from, our origins, the origin of the universe, and so forth. And we realize that everything we've been taught before this point by the professionals were lies, and we can prove it up and down all over the place.
Up and down all over the place.
Up and down all over the place. And down all over the place.
Every evolutionist attempt in the 20th century to account for the origin of life has ended in failure. Jeffrey Beta, a professor of geochemistry and a leading advocate of the theory of evolution, confesses this fact in the February 1998 issue of Earth.
Today, as we leave the 20th century, we still face the biggest problem that we had when we entered the 20th century. How did life originate on Earth?
The biggest impasse confronting evolution is the incredibly complex structure of the living cell. Every living thing on Earth is made up of cells about a hundredth of a millimeter in size. Some living things are made up of a single cell. Yet even these single cell organisms are remarkably complex in their composition. They have complicated functions to survive and even little motors to move. In Darwin's time, this complex structure of the cell was unknown. With the primitive microscopes of those days, cells appeared to be little more than featureless stains. However, powerful electron microscopes invented around the middle of the 20th century began revealing just how complex and organized a living cell really was. They laid bare a complexity and organization that could not be a product of chance. A living cell is comprised of thousands of tiny parts that work in harmony. To make a comparison, within the cell, there are power stations, high-tech factories, a complex data bank, huge storage systems, advanced refineries, and a seemingly conscious cell membrane that controls what enters and leaves the cell. In order for the cell to survive, all of these organelles have to exist at the same time. It is impossible that such an intricate and complex system could have emerged as a result of coincidences.
So there's a big question. If you're just kind of trying to assess, how likely is it that we'd find a protein by chance with all the amino acids in that prebiotic soup interacting with each other for, say, billions of years. And I give it a lot of time. How likely is it that we'd ever get a protein to arise by chance? So I have a colleague who's been interested in the whole question of whether or not life could arise by chance for a long time. His name is Doug Axe. He's a molecular biologist. He did his PhD at Caltech. He worked for 14 years at Cambridge University, and he wanted to find out how common or how rare are the functional sequences of amino acids among the big space of all the possible amino acids there are. And he came up with a really amazing number. And it's 10 to the 74 power. So just to get the amino acid sequence properly, you've got an odds of about 1 in 10 to the 74. But there's other probabilistic hurdles that have to be overcome. If you want to build a protein, we know from chemistry that you have to attach the amino acids together with what's called a peptide bond. In nature, peptide bonds occur with about a 1 in 2 frequency. Half the bonds that form between amino acids are peptide bonds, half aren't. But if you get any bonds forming that aren't peptide bonds, you can't form a protein. So to form a protein, 150 amino acids long, you've got a 1 in 2 chance at each site of getting the correct type of linkage. So you got 1 in 2 times 1 in 2 times 1 in 2 times 1 in 2 to the what power? Close to 150. Since we got linkages, we have 149, but call it 150, okay? So another way, we got another huge exponential problem to overcome. So, and it turns out that 1 in 2 to the 150 is the same number as 10 to the 45th, 1 in 10 to the 45. So now we got two incredibly improbable things that we've got to overcome to build a functional protein by chance alone. One more problem. When you're building proteins, amino acids come in two flavors. There's a left-handed flavor and a right-handed flavor. They're called optical isomers, not flavors, okay? And the left-handed version is the only kind that can be used in building proteins. You get even one right-handed amino acid in there and your protein won't fold properly. So you got another probabilistic hurdle to overcome. So you've got a 1 in 2 chance at each site again, out to the 150th power. 2 to the 150th power, again, is 10 to the 45. Oh my goodness. So the odds of building even a short functional protein by chance alone is 74 plus 40. You can remember how you do this in math. You can add the exponents if you're multiplying exponential numbers.
164.
Thank you very much. Okay? Wow. Now, can anyone get their mind around a number that big? There's only 10 to the 80th elementary particles in the entire universe. There's only 10 to the 16th seconds since the Big Bang. There's only 10 to the 139th total events since the beginning of the universe. Now you're starting to get the understanding of why people are very skeptical that the chance hypothesis is going to do the job. Now, you may have heard just the opposite. Has anyone ever gotten in a discussion with you about the origin of life and said, hey, it happened by chance? I mean, do you hear that? I mean, this happens to me. I'll be lecturing in hostile university environments, and I'll get done, and somebody say, well, but, and they want to argue with me about the probabilities. And I just shut the discussion down because I say, no serious scientist thinks this is the way it happened. No serious scientist thinks this is the way it happened. No serious scientist thinks this is the way it happened. No serious scientist thinks this is the way it happened. No serious
scientist. Modern biochemistry has also revealed the unimaginably complex design of the DNA molecule. The structure of the DNA molecule was discovered by two scientists, James Watson and Francis Crick, in 1955. Their discovery demonstrated that life was much more complex than anyone had previously envisioned. Himself a confirmed evolutionist, Francis Crick, who received a Nobel Prize for this discovery, came to confess that a structure like DNA could never have emerged by chance.
Professor Anthony Flew of England and Reading University is the world's foremost academic atheist over the last 50 years and the author of more than 30 books. His first debate with former atheist turned Christian, C.S. Lewis, in 1950 in Oxford, England, was the first time he advanced his argument for atheism. He later wrote a paper titled Theology and Falsification. The paper became the most widely reprinted philosophical publication of the last half century and a key foundation for atheists and agnostics who advanced materialist evolutionism. But now it is the advancement of science itself that has changed the mind of Flew and some scientists. At a recent summit at New York University, Flew changed his position and now believes in God as the creator of the universe. Flew turns to various discoveries of science to prove his point. But it is the manifestation of life written in DNA and the transcription of DNA to RNA and RNA into protein and the subsequent process of protein folding that makes the best case for Flew.
What I think that the DNA material has done has shown by its quite almost unbelievable complexity of the arrangements which lead to produce this being, that intelligence must have been involved in getting these extraordinarily diverse elements to work together.
When you look at RNA, you as a chemist, you're in sort of astonishment, really, at just what a wonderful molecule it is. It's complex, it's a really beautiful structure, and you inevitably wonder, how on earth did that structure arise? How on earth did chemistry produce it?
RNA's structure looks simple. But looks can deceive. Each building block is actually made of two parts, a sugar molecule and a nuclear base.
Chemists found they could make the nuclear bases. And so when they then realized they could actually make the sugars, they just thought, we must be able to join them together. And so they tried for many years, but the problem was, chemically, you just can't join them together.
Of course, such an amazing structure could never have been formed by chance. The theory of evolution, which sees life as the result of mere coincidences and haphazard happenings, is helpless to explain anything in the face of the incredible complexity of DNA.
Some evolutionists say that our DNA is about 98% similar to that of apes, and that this difference is only a few spelling mistakes. Others say a more accurate figure is no more than 95%. But considering that humans have 3 billion letters worth of DNA information in each cell, even a 2% difference is actually 60 million spelling errors. Of course, this is not error, but 20 500-page books worth of new information. A common designer is a much better explanation for the similarities in human and ape DNA. As an architect uses the same building materials for different buildings, we shouldn't be surprised if God used similar design features in many different creatures. After all, we do share about 50% of our DNA with bananas, but that doesn't mean we're half banana.
Every detail of a living being's physical and physiological makeup is coded in this double helix. All the information about our bodies, from the color of our eyes to the structure of our internal organs and the shape and function of our cells, are programmed in sections called genes in the DNA. The DNA code is made up of the sequence of four different bases. If we think of each one of these bases as a letter, DNA can be likened to a data bank made up of an alphabet of four letters. All the information about a living thing is stored in this data bank.
If you found an ancient clay tablet with strange characters washed up on the shore, you couldn't read it, unless someone had cracked the code. But you'd still know the letters represented a language, even if you didn't know anything else about the author or his civilization. Language is recognizable, even if you can't read it. Take Morse code. It has three basic parts: dots, dashes, and spaces. These three simple parts are combined to represent letters. There are 26 letters in the English language, which are combined to form over 400,000 words. Those words can, of course, be combined into an infinite number of sequences or sentences. There is evidence that DNA represents a language. Four basic units, called nucleotides, combine into a code for 20 amino acids. From those few amino acids, the body forms more than 100,000 proteins. Even if you can't read DNA, it still has all the hallmarks of language. a language that biologists are just now beginning to crack. Every tiny cell in our body is packed with 3 feet of DNA, 3 billion nucleotides. The similarity between DNA and human language is uncanny. In addition to codes, both use similar techniques to pack, access, rearrange, copy, and translate information. DNA seems to represent a language, the language of life. An unseen author, the creator of heaven and earth, has left a testimony of his existence in the DNA of every living thing.
Okay, in this video, I'm just going to show you a little bit about the genetic code. So what I have here written on my whiteboard is the left half of a DNA molecule. And if I ask you to complete the right side of the DNA molecule, you should be able to fill in the bases that would bond in the complementary base pairing fashion. So that's how you would complete that. C's and G's go together, and A's and T's go together. And that's pretty simple. Now, when we start learning about protein synthesis, we usually use part of the DNA molecule to act as a pattern for transcription and translation. So let me just erase this part, and let's say that we are using this DNA as the beginning of transcription. And so this is half of my DNA molecule, and I would like to know what mRNA is going to bond next to this DNA in the nucleus during transcription. So I would have G for guanine, C, A, G, G, U, A, A, and G. So this is my messenger RNA. Messenger RNA comes into the nucleus and copies the DNA code. So that's my messenger RNA. And the messenger RNA will now take this code out of the nucleus, and it will arrive at the ribosome. So now, let's say that that messenger RNA has arrived at the ribosome, and transfer RNA is going to bond next to the messenger RNA. So that will be C, G, U, C, C, A, U, U, C. And that's my messenger, that's my transfer RNA, excuse me. So this green, this is my transfer RNA. And I might ask, how many amino acids is this genetic code going to code for? Basically, every three bases in a row is going to be carrying one amino acid. So this would code for a particular amino acid. This one would code for a particular amino acid. And then this one would also code for an amino acid. And you can actually look up on a table which amino acid is being carried by those tRNAs. When you use a table, it's probably going to be called a messenger RNA codon table. All right, and so we would want to read the codons from our messenger RNA. So my first codon that I'd want to look up is this one right here. This is my messenger RNA. I would want to look up GCA. I don't know if you can see that very clearly. So my first codon that I want to look up is GCA, and I might use a table like this. And so you start in the very middle of the circle, and I would read the G for the first letter, C for my second one, and A for my third one. And I don't think you can really read this, but it is coding for the amino acid alanine. Let's see if I can zoom in on that for you. So G, C, A is coding for alanine. So that is what amino acid would be carried by this first transfer RNA that's in my sequence here. So the amino acid alanine would be attached to this transfer RNA. So that's alanine. And then I could look up the next one, GGU, on my codon chart. Let's do that together. GGU. I'll hold it a little closer here. So we start with G, and then we go to G, and then we go to U. I'm sorry. GGU, and that is going to code for glycine. So glycine would be the next amino acid, and so on. So that's how you can code and decode with your DNA and your messenger RNA and your tRNA. Hope that helps.
The information that is stored in the DNA molecule is pointing back to a designing intelligence. Now, why do I say that? It has to do with what we know about the cause and effect structure of the world. Our local hero in Seattle, Bill Gates, says that DNA is like a software program, only much more complex than any we've ever created. And that's a very suggestive remark, because we know that programs always come from programmers. And in fact, we know generally that information, whether it's in a computer program or a hieroglyphic inscription or in a headline in a newspaper or a block of text in a book, information always comes from an intelligent source. So
yes,
when we find information in the DNA molecule, the most logical thing to conclude is that it too had an intelligent source.
As far as I'm concerned, I'm here to tell you, Michael, this morning, and Jason, evolution is dead. Long live the creator. I'll tell you why. And I'm saying science says that as a scientist. Evolution is dead because there's such thing as the minimal gene set concept. They've taken a mycoplasma, smallest organism, Mycoplasma genitalium, which is the smallest organism that is known to exist, has 468 genes. A gene is a mix of proteins, right? Mm-hmm. A list of, so it can be 1,000, can be 10,000 amino acids. Okay, they're 486, and they've decided since year 2000, they've said, let's try to reduce it, because we have to start, if you're going to be an evolutionist, you have to start with zero genes and build up if you're going to go from hydrogen to human. And so somewhere along the way, they said, well, let's take it down. In the year 2000, they published that even on paper, they couldn't go below 200 genes. On the 6th of January 2006 in Nature, they published that in reality, you could only go down to 397 genes. So a cell, which is where my specialty lies in my scientific work, a cell needs a specific number of components to be functional. You have a membrane, but then you need to feed the membrane. So you have to have some mitochondria. You need a way of tagging the proteins. You need some DNA. So you need 397 things. Just the glucose cycle for getting energy takes over six different genes. So if you don't have one of them, you don't have any more energy coming to the cell.
Is new information being generated? That's what evolutionists have to come up with.
Right.
They have to have a mechanism that generates new, never before existing genetic information.
Right.
That can build all these bigger and better structures.
Right. That supposedly never existed before.
Right.
Right.
Never before existing information. Right. Back when there was only a single cell that gave rise to all the diversity of life, there wasn't information
right.
for skin and hair and heart and a brain and so on.
Right.
So you have to generate it somehow, according to evolution.
Right.
Now, Dr. Werner Gitt is an information specialist. Since we're talking about information, we'll go to an information specialist.
Okay.
He wrote a book called In the Beginning Was Information that you and I both both love.
Mm-hmm.
And in his book, he says this: a code system is always the result of a mental process. It requires an intelligent origin or inventor.
Mm-hmm.
It should be emphasized that matter as such is unable to generate any code. All experiences indicate that a thinking being voluntarily exercising his own free will, cognition, and creativity is required.
Right.
He goes on to say, there is no known law of nature, no known process, and no known sequence of events which can cause information to originate by itself in matter.
Right.
This is why Professor Richard Dawkins, one of the most renowned advocates of the theory of evolution of our day, hesitates when he is asked to give a single example that increases the genetic information.
Professor Dawkins, can you give an example of a genetic mutation or an evolutionary process which can be seen to increase the information in the genome?
The truth is very evident. Life has such a complex design that can never come about by chance.
And I suppose it's possible that you might find evidence for that if you look at the details of biochemistry, molecular biology. You might find a signature of some sort of designer.
Wait a second. Richard Dawkins thought intelligent design might be a legitimate pursuit?
Richard Dawkins is his name. Arguably the world's most famous atheist. I don't know how you would test for that, but maybe we'll ask him. So, right off the bat, what's wrong with, in your opinion, with believing in a god, regardless of who the god is?
I think it's false. I think that it's a matter of belief without evidence. And I suppose it's possible that you might find evidence for that if you look at the details of biochemistry, molecular biology. You might find a signature of some sort of designer.
Wait a second. Richard Dawkins thought intelligent design might be a legitimate pursuit?
And that designer could well be a higher intelligence from elsewhere in the universe.
Harvard University discovers message from God in our DNA code. Researchers at Harvard University announced today that they have found what appears to be a message from God written inside the human genome. In a little explored section of non-coding DNA, a team of top geneticists discovered a 22-word snippet of ancient Aramaic in which God confirms his existence and his role in creating life on Earth. The stunning finding represents nearly irrefutable evidence of God's existence and his role in creating the process of evolution of natural selection. The message was discovered when researchers noticed strange mathematical patterns appearing within a certain section of the genome. For heaven's sake! We knew the patterns weren't naturally occurring, explains Charles Watson, the lead scientist on the project, but we couldn't come up with any convincing explanation for them. On a whim, we started cross-referencing the patterns with language databases, he explains. And we were shocked to find that the patterns corresponded to ancient Aramaic. Stunned by its discovery, the team contacted language experts familiar with Aramaic, the language Jesus Christ spoke in daily life. Entirely decoded, the message reads, "Hello, my children. This is Yahweh, the one true Lord. You have found creation's secret. Now share it peacefully with the world." Yahweh is the biblical name for the Judeo-Christian God. The findings will be published in the journal Nature next month, and are expected to provoke the biggest scientific controversy since Charles Darwin published his theory of natural selection in 1859. This doesn't mean that the theory of evolution is wrong, says Watson. It's just incomplete. It seems that in reality the Judeo-Christian God actually started the whole process. And instead of just telling us about natural selection, he left a hidden signature that we could find 200,000 years later when we invented the right technology. It makes total sense, really. Before this discovery, I was a committed atheist. Now I'm a devout Christian. This is exactly the kind of proof I needed to ease my doubts. In addition to its profound impact on science, the news is set to revolutionize the world of comparative religion. I think the message clearly indicates that God wants us to coexist peacefully with our fellow human beings, says Janice Taylor, a bishop in the Anglican Church.
Where we're having an enlightening discussion with scientist and best-selling author Greg Braden of the USA. When he first began studying human origins, Mr. Braden wondered whether humankind was just a genetic coincidence or was intentionally engineered. Let's now find out how his research took shape.
I don't know who or what or how, but the evidence is overwhelming that there is an intentionality and a design that underlies our existence. So as a scientist, my thinking was, if that's true, who or whatever put us here on Earth would have left something inside of every one of us that tells us we're part of a greater existence and tells us that we're a family and that we're not so different from one another. And if I could find that, if I could find that common denominator that somehow maybe it would help us to become greater than the differences. That began the search. And I combined the science that I know of biology and history and ancient language, linguistics, genetics, with the new science of computers that were now on my desktop. And Daryl, I'll tell you, I remember the very first time as a scientist that I had the opportunity to see the human genome, a piece of human DNA coded on my computer screen. And all the CTAG, CTAG, it all rolled down through the screen. And my brain looked at that. And I remember thinking, I said, I don't know what that says, but there's a code. There's a language. That DNA is a language. And whatever that language is, it's inside of me, and it's inside of everyone that looks at it. And some intelligent being placed it there a long time ago.
Using all the technology at his disposal, Mr. Braden then began searching for the message encoded in our DNA.
And this led to a research project using computers, the best science of today, and some of those ancient texts. And the bottom line is that what we discovered is every single ancient language, the letters of the language link to very precise numbers that have never changed. So whether we're talking about the Arabic language or the Hebrew language, or if we're talking about cuneiform and Sanskrit, what are called the ancient core or the ancient root languages, there's a mysterious number that's always been linked to those letters, and nobody knows where the numbers came from. That was interesting to me. So through a process that took many years, I came to understand that the numbers that represent the letter are also the numbers that represent the elements, what we call the elements on the periodic table of life and a physical reality as we know it. So in other words, it is if the ancients, they didn't know about the periodic table of elements the way we do today, but they knew about the numbers that were represented. And when we make the connections between the letters of the ancient alphabets, the numbers they represent, those numbers, if we look at them on the periodic table, they happen to be precisely the elements that make the DNA in our bodies. Now, we have the ability to take the sequences of DNA in a cell and through those numbers link them to letters in ancient alphabets. And lo and behold, the letters spell words and the words have meaning. And this has led to a book that's entitled The God Code. It was released in the year 2004. What we know is that there is a message, an intentional message, within the DNA of all life. The message is occurs in layers, and each layer has its own code that must be understood for that layer. And I'm still working on the deeper layers.
Greg Braden says the message hidden in the DNA of all living beings is that which spiritual masters have tried to convey to humanity through the ages. He now reveals what's written in the topmost layer of our genetic code.
The top layer is one that we understand very well right now. The top layer in the DNA of all life literally translates into the words God, eternal within the body. God, eternal within the body. We don't know who put that message there. We don't know exactly why it's there. But I can tell you that all I did was I followed the instructions in a series of ancient texts, following those languages, and I married that with the science of today, and this is what we found. If a higher intelligence is responsible for our existence, and that intelligence created us, it makes perfect sense that that intelligence would have left something for us to understand who we are. And if they left it in a temple or a text that could be destroyed or disappear over time, it wouldn't make sense. It makes perfect sense that that higher intelligence would have left the message encoded into the creation itself. And as long as the creation exists, the message is intact.
In the 20th century, the theory of evolution was refuted not only by molecular biology, but also by paleontology, that is, fossil science.
A second proof usually offered is the fossil record. According to most biology textbooks, fossils show the gradual development of life from simple to complex over hundreds of millions of years. But a growing number of scientists say that this textbook story is incomplete and even misleading, because it ignores an extraordinary event in the history of life known as the Cambrian explosion.
The oldest stratum of the Earth in which fossils of living creatures have been found is that of the Cambrian, which has an estimated age of 500 to 530 million years. In strata older than the Cambrian, no fossils of any creatures except a few unicellular organisms are to be seen. In the Cambrian period, however, many diverse species appear quite abruptly. More than 30 invertebrate species, such as jellyfish, starfish, trilobites, and snails, emerge all of a sudden.
In Darwin's theory, if you think of the branching tree, Darwin's branching tree, the common ancestor down here, and the different modern forms of animals up here, you would have one form to begin with, and then it would gradually diverge into slightly different forms and more different until you get the major differences that we see now. The problem with the Cambrian explosion is that all these major differences appear together at the same time, with no fossil evidence that they descended from this common ancestor.
The article reported on cutting-edge research by Chinese scientist J.Y. Chen, an internationally respected paleontologist at the Nanjing Institute of Paleontology and Geology. Chen's discoveries in the fossil beds in Xinjiang, China, have rocked the scientific establishment. Located in the province of Yunnan in southern China, Xinjiang has some of the world's best-preserved fossils from the Cambrian era.
Darwinism helps them, maybe only telling a part story for evolution.
According to Chen, the fossils he's discovered turn Darwin's tree of life upside down.
Darwin's tree, you know, reverse conscience, very unexpectedly, our research convincing major phylum starting down below at beginning of Cambrian. Base is white, gradually narrow, so this is almost turned on different way.
This situation refutes the theory of evolution for sure, because Darwin wrote in The Origin of Species, if numerous species belonging to the same genera or families have really started into life all at once, the fact would be fatal to the theory of descent with slow modification through natural selection. This fatal stroke that frightened Darwin comes from the Cambrian period, right at the outset of the fossil record. No fossil remains supporting evolution have ever been unearthed in excavations conducted in every corner of the world.
Professor Roberto Fondi is a specialist in paleontology. He teaches at the Department of Earth Sciences in the University of Siena in Italy.
You may be surprised to know that the fundamental assumptions upon which evolutionary thinking is based are not at all confirmed by paleontology. All the biological groups, from bacteria and blue-green algae to man, appear abruptly in the fossil record without any links connecting them with each other. The fact is that after nearly two centuries of intense research, the paleontological evidence for evolutionary theory is not only rare, but highly questionable. The point is that if evolution had really happened, the evidence would be in great abundance and incontestable. The museums would be overflowing with fossils, clearly documenting the transitions between the various biological groups. Yet there are none. Moreover, there is no indication that the situation will change in the future. Those very few fossils which are claimed to show some kind of evolutionary link, such as the amphibians Ichthyostica and Simoria, the reptile Propnognathus, the bird, Archaeopteryx, and the Australopithecine ape, called Homo habilis, are very far from conclusive.
Is they are absolutely propagandizing the world with all of their theses about the nature of the universe that we live in, where we come from, our origins, the origin of the universe, and so forth, so forth, so forth.
The project is literally the secularization of the world, to completely strip the world from religious beliefs. This is the project, and that is why it is called Novus Ordo Seclorum, a new secular or worldly order.
A new study.
All of you are engaged in running your mouths, doing your business, multiplying, buying houses, cars, business, whatever you're doing. And when you're told about God, religion, life, morality, you're saying, look, I ain't got no time for that.
Because this media is here and designed to make sure that they ask no critical questions. To make sure that the only thing that they are concerned about is having a good time. The only thing they're concerned about is filling their bellies. The only thing they're concerned about is acquiring more and more material things.
Lots of people say there's no evidence for God. Well, we're going to knock that one out in three. I'm just going to have to keep it simple, throw in the old 1-2 combo, get in and out real quick, and let you fine folks chat all about it, okay? Punch one I'm going to call the info uppercut. When's the last time you walked into a library and asked, hey, where are all the books that have been written by mindless products of natural laws? The librarian would probably laugh at you and tell you that no such books exist. They don't exist because they can't exist. Why not? Because first of all, it's just common sense. The words that form the message in books always originate from a person with a brain. Or to say it a bit more scientifically, the message of the book, the purpose, comes to be understood by the orderly placement of the words, design, and information. Ah, information. Now, anytime we find info, these basic laws always apply. Number one, matter doesn't spontaneously produce information. Number two, only a mental source, intelligence, can generate new creative information. In other words, just like those books that couldn't originate without a mind, neither could life. Why not, you ask? Because we know that DNA contains information. Therefore, the laws of information science apply, which means the information in DNA couldn't have spontaneously generated, and that a mind is behind the information. Period. No exceptions. Look at it this way. The simplest life form we know of is an amoeba, and it contains as much information in its DNA as 1,000 complete sets of Encyclopedia Britannica. So, are we to believe that there's no way a message in a library book could spontaneously generate, but far more complicated messages in DNA that contain 1,000 times more information could have? Not likely. You see, when it comes to life or anything else that contains information, the laws of information science confirm the necessity of a creative mind. And guess what? In the very first book of the Bible, it just happens to mention that. In the beginning, God created. Bam. Uppercut lands on the chin. And now here comes the indefensible head blow. We'll call this the not a big bang bing swing, the KO to the claim that there's no evidence of God, the law of causality left hook of doom. It goes like this. Everything that had a beginning had a cause. The universe had a beginning, therefore the universe had a cause. Now, either something caused the universe to come into existence, or nothing caused it. Huh. I might not be the smartest guy behind the telescope, but honest, practical, everyday thinking's gonna lead me to the former. You have to work pretty hard to conjure up a way that nothing did it. You see, it's pretty improbable, nigh impossible, to account for design, information, and cause if the universe just exploded from nothing. Smack. And while we're on the topic, where did the matter come from that exploded? Are we really to believe that there was nothing and then it exploded, and now the exploded nothing is something, and we just happen to be smart enough to discover and understand the very laws that prove the opposite? And if the general understanding of the law of cause and effect is true, how can matter come from a lesser cause? Like nothing. I mean, come on. I don't have a bunch of letters after my name, but even a monkey knows better. And yeah, I snuck in a couple of extra jabs in there, so sue me. Now for some parting words from our sponsor, the Bible. It tells us in Romans 1:20 that since the creation of the world, God's invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so they are without excuse. It also says that people actually know the truth, but they reject it, which explains why even though there's overwhelming evidence that there is a God, evidence won't convince the unwilling. Sad but true. So there you have it. With just a couple of meaningful blows, the claim that there is no evidence for God is down for the count, mi amigos. In other words, it's been debunked. Adios.